Good morning all. Myself Priya, working as an assistant professor, Department of Mechatronics, Bharat Institute of Higher Education and Research. I'm handling the subject Transducer Engineering, course code U18, PCMT406. Today, let us discuss about the topic, a variable resistance transducer. First, all of you know about the variable resistance transducer. What is meant by transducer? It converts one form of energy into another form of energy. So this type of transducer most commonly used type. That variable resistance transducer are also called as a resistive transducer or resistive sensors. They can be used for measuring various physical quantities such as temperature, pressure, displacement, force and vibrations. These transducers are usually used as the secondary transducer, where the output from the primary mechanical transducer acts as the input for the variable resistance transducer. The output often is calibrated against the input quantity and it directly gives the value of the input. The variable resistance transducer elements work on the principle on the resistance of the conductor. That means this formula. R is equal to rho L divided by A. So the resistance is directly proportional to the length of the conductor and inversely proportional to the area. Okay, what is the unit of the resistance? It's a ohm. Length, it's a meter. Okay, area, it's a meter square. Okay, this is the principle. Next, L is the length, A is the cross-sectional area, P is the resistive of the resistance material. So the any one of the parameter we have to change, na another two parameter will be changed. That means the resistance can be changed if any of this value. That means rho L A is changed. Measurement is connected to the resistance in such a way that it varies any one of its parameter. A change in the value R is proportional to the measurement. This is the measurement can be measured by measuring the change in resistance, where rho is called as resistivity of the material and it is constant for the materials and it's measured in ohm meter. The resistance of some materials also changes with the change in their temperature. This principle is primarily used for the measurement of temperature. Okay, next the topic is what is meant by displacement sensor, position sensor, proximity sensor. First, we have to discuss the displacement. Displacement means measures amount by which the object has moved any one of the direction. Position means measures position of the some object with respect to some reference position. Proximity, okay, proximity is the sensitivity. Tells whether object has moved within some particular distance or not. This proximity sensor always used in the cars. And next, what are the types of resistive transducer used? First one is the potentiometer, strain gauge, capacitive element, differential transformer, eddy current proximity sensor, inductive proximity switches, optical encoders, pneumatic sensors, proximity switches, Hall effect sensors. First, we are, you know, the selection criteria of the resistive transducer. A number of static and dynamic factors must be considered in selecting a suitable sensor to measure the desired physical parameter. So this is the following factors. First one is the range, resolution, accuracy. Precision. Precision is nothing but ability to reproduce repeatedly with a given accuracy. That means we are using the lab experiment, means we already taking the 10 readings or 12 readings. Okay, it's a repeatability readings. Okay, next one is the sensitivity. Third one is the linearity. Linearity is nothing but the percentage of deviation from the best fit linear calibration curve. Next one is the response time, bandwidth, frequency at which the output magnitude drops by the 3 dB. Next, what is meant by response? The frequency at which the output magnitude peak across value. Next one is the operating temperature. The range in which the sensor performance has specified values. Okay, next one is the dead band. The range of input for which there is no output. Signal to noise ratio, SNR. Okay, the ratio between the magnitudes of the signal and the noise at the output values. Next, we are discussing about the topic is potentiometer. Okay, what is meant by potentiometer? It is a displacement measuring device. It is a variable resistance device whose output resistance changes as the wiper connected to a moving object moves across a resistive surface. This can be used for linear or rotary displacement. We are using the electrical machines lab means we are using the rheostat. So the rheostat is also called as a potentiometer. Okay, two points are fixed, another one point is a moving direction. So then moving point is a linear or rotary displacement. Okay, here the displacement is converted into a potential difference. Okay, that means the voltage value. This is the practical potentiometer view. Okay, wow. First one is the practical potentiometer view. Three points is there. Okay, next one is the 1, 2, 3. 1 and 3 are fixed point. 3 are variable points. Okay. In third diagram, it's a wiper showing that one second values 1, 2 are constant. Okay. So the third one is a wiper. We want the 10 ohm means we have to rotating this wiper. Okay. In 100 ohm, 10 ohm, 20 ohm means we have to adjusting the that wiper position. Okay. Then constant input voltage, that means VI between terminal 1 and 3. Okay, 1 and 3 is a constant voltage. Output voltage V naught between terminal 2 and 3. This one is a, we want 20 ohm means 20 ohm is a starting point, 3 is a ending point. Okay, next, VI is the input voltage, V naught is a output voltage. R1, R2 are variable resistance. And RL is the internal resistance of the voltmeter. Okay, this is the simple diagram. Okay, this is the input voltage R1, R2. This one is the RL, the output voltage. Okay, R1, R2. This one is the first and third point are fixed. Okay, second point, that means the R2 value. This is the changed. In between, in previous slide, the principle and working of the resistive transducer means rho L by A, that means L the length of the conductor. Okay, so potentiometer calibration when X is equal to 0, R1 equal to R max. Okay, when X is value is the 0 means R1 is equal to R maximum, R2 equal to 0 value. Okay, X is equal to X maximum means R2 is a maximum value, R1 getting a 0. So, thus R1 into 1 minus X divided by X maximum into R maximum. So, we want the R2 value. So, R2 is equal to X divided by X maximum R maximum. So, the VI is nothing but the input voltage minus output voltage. Okay, input, this one is the input voltage, this one is the output voltage is equal to IR1. And this is the, so we want the input current. Okay, so I is equal to VI minus V0 divided by R1. So output voltage V0 is equal to IR2 means, so VI minus, we know the value of I. So we substituting the I value in the second equation. So replacing the VI minus V0 divided by R1 into R2. We want the output voltage. So output voltage divided by R2 divided by R1 plus R2 into VI. Okay, well, this one is the diagram V0. Output voltage is equal to nothing but R2 divided by R1 plus R2 into VI. Okay, R2 divided by R maximum. R1 plus R2 is equal to R maximum VI. Okay, so in previous slide, X is equal to X maximum values. Okay, V0 is equal to VI divided by X maximum into X value. Okay, this is the simple potentiometer, how to calculate the output voltage. Okay, next we have to know about the strain gauge. What is mean by strain gauge? The electrical resistance, strain gauge is a metal wire, metal foil strip or a strip of semiconductor material which can be passed on surface. When subjected to strain, its resistance R changes. Fractional change in resistance, del R by R, E is proportional to strain. So del R divided by R is equal to G epsilon. So del L it's represent the change. L means length. So change in length divided by original length. G is a constant of proportionality called gauge factor. This one is the G for metal wire, foil strain gauges with the metal is about 2. G for silicon, P-type semiconductor strain gauge is about plus 100. Silicon N-type semiconductor means it's a minus 100. G is supplied by a manufacturer. What are the disadvantages of the strain gauge means? is that resistance not only changes with strain but also with temperature. And this is the diagrams of strain gauge. Okay, this is the backing and encapsulation. This one is the grid. This one is the end loop alignment mask, solder tabs. Okay, and the commercially available form of our metal foil. This strain gauge we are using the strain of the body. Okay, in normally practically we are know about the weight means we are simply standing that strain gauge means we are that strain gauge showing the some display. Okay, 53 kg or 60 kg. Okay, so now we are using the commercial purpose. This one is the semiconductor device, gold leads electrodes. This one is the base metal. This is the semiconductor type same strain gauge. Okay, strain gauge are put on the top and bottom portion of a cantilever beam. Okay, this is the strain gauge. Oh, so strain gauge on the top of the cantilever beam in and the undeflected beam position. This strain gauge when the connected as the arms of the Wheatstone bridge circuit causes the bridge to be okay. This is the cantilever beam. So we have to put the strain gauge at the top of the cantilever beam. This one is the strain gauge 2. This is the test position. Okay. We are calculating voltage means we are using the bridge balance circuit. Okay. So bridge balance circuit means we are the resistance is connected in the parallel manner. And then we are calculating the voltage. We are using the galvanometer also. Case when an end load, that means pure moment or pure bending load has been applied on the cantilever, causing the bending of the cantilever when strain gauge 1 subjected to stretching, whereas strain gauge 2 is subjected to compression. So this is the strain gauge 1, this one is the strain gauge 2, correct? So we are applying the force into the strain gauge 1 means the cantilever beam, we have the flexible bending motion is occur. Okay. At the time, we are using the galvanometer. At the time, we calculating the voltage. In this case, the beam bends with a constant curvature along its length. And as a result, the resistance R1 and R2 in the bridge circuit changes. The galvanometer reading then becomes non-zero and the bridge can be balanced by varying the resistance R3 and R4. Okay, so that the galvanometer gives zero reading. Okay, we are using the R1, R2. Okay, we are applying the force in this one means R3 and R4, we are varying this resistance. So that galvanometer gives the zero reading. So R1 divided by R2 is equal to R3 divided by R4. Why we are writing this manner means the R1 and R2 is a parallel connection. So R1 divided by R2 is equal to R3 divided by R4 equal to R plus del R divided by R minus del R. So epsilon is equal to del R by R. Del it's nothing but then change in resistance divided by original resistance. Okay. This is the capacitance value. Okay. The capacitance C for of a parallel plate. Okay. This is the two parallel plate moves and change the diameters. Epsilon R relative permittivity of the dielectric between the two plates. Okay. Epsilon naught is a constant term permittivity of free space. A is the area of overlap between two plates. Okay. This one is the area. Okay. This is the overlap area. Plate moves and changes the area. D is the plate separation. Capacitor is given by C. Epsilon naught, epsilon R, A divided by T. This is the formula of capacitors. Push-pull displacement sensor. That means C1 is equal to epsilon R A divided by D plus X. Okay. C2 is equal to epsilon R divided by D minus X divided by epsilon. C1 is in one arm of an AC bridges and C2 in the other. Then resulting output balance voltage is proportional to X. Okay, this is the commercially available form of strain gauge. Okay, next we are discussing about the linear variable displacement transducer. Okay, so linear variable displacement transducer is a transducer for measuring linear displacement. It consists of primary and secondary winding and a movable iron core. Okay. This is the diagram for LVDT. This one is the primary winding. This one is the secondary winding. Okay. This one is the primary. This one is the secondary winding. Okay. It function much like a transformer. Okay, a transformer is a primary and secondary winding is there. Once we have to apply the voltage means, then the primary voltage, it's a magnetic field produced. Okay, so the function, wherever voltage are induced in the secondary coil, there is by excitation in the primary coil. So we have to apply the input voltage in the primary coil means, at that time magnetic field created. Then secondary coil, it's produced the magnetic field. Okay. And positive, negative. We are using the AC current. Okay. AC na alternating current. So output of the graph itself, sinusoidal waveform. This one is the VI, it's a time. So it's excitation voltage. Next, V naught, output voltage with the core left of null. Okay. Core left of null position means it's a voltage is slightly moving leftwards. Okay. The output voltage with core null position means it is an opposite of the left to null. Okay. Next, the LVDT must be excited by an AC signal to induce an AC response in the secondary. Okay. We are using the AC voltage now. So we get the graph result also AC signals. The core position can be determined by using the secondary response. When two secondary coils connected in the series opposing configuration are shown. Okay. This two windings, primary and secondary windings are connected in a series manner. Okay. The output signal describes both the magnitude and direction of the core motion. There is a midpoint in the core position where the voltage induced in each coil of the same amplitude and 180 out of phase, producing a null output. Okay. And this is the graph represent. As the core moves from the null position, the output amplitude increases a proportional amount over a linear range of around the null. Therefore, by measuring the output voltage amplitude, we can easily and accurately determine the magnitude of the core displacement. Okay, this one is the core displacement, left and right angle. This one is the core displacement. Okay, once we have to move the left and right means, we have to change in the values. Okay, that this is the linear rate. This one is the V naught amplitude. It's a curve variation. By determining the direction of the core displacement, the secondary coils can be connected to a demodulation circuit. The diode bridges in this circuit produce a positive or negative rectifier sine wave, depending on which side of the null position the core is located. Okay, this is the two bridge rectifiers we are using. This one is the secondary, this also secondary coils. This one is the core, it's a magnetic field and associated with the voltage polarities. One is the primary coil, another one is the secondary coil. We are applying the primary voltage means at that time we have to produce the magnetic flux. At that time secondary coils, it produce the voltage between the two bridge rectifiers. Okay. So it's produced a primary secondary voltages, excitation voltage. And next one is the output voltage with core left of null. Next one is the output voltage with core right of null. This is the commercially available form of the LVDT. Okay. Next one is the optical encoder. An encoder is a device that converts a linear or angular displacement into a sequence of pulses. Okay. Encoder is nothing but a calculating values, okay, angular displacement, and it's a sequence of pulses. By counting these pulses, we can obtain the linear or angular displacement. Encoders comes in two basic forms. One is a incremental encoder, another one is the absolute encoder. Incremental encoders gives a rotational with respect to some reference position, whereas absolute encoders gives a actual position. Okay, two encoder, one is the absolute encoders in a incremental encoder. Incremental encoder means the rotational wise, we have to add in the values. Okay. Next, incremental encoder. The beam of light, which is from a LED, passes through slots in a disc. Okay. This is the diagram. Incremental encoder. This beam of light is, this one is the LED light. Okay. This light is detected by the light sensor, that way photoresistor placed at the other side of the disc. When the disc rotates, disc rotates, a pulsed output is produced by the photoresistor. The number of pulses received by photoresistor is proportional to the angle through with the disc has rotated. Okay. Actually, three concentric tracks with the three sensor are used in the incremental encoders, where sigma is the angle subtended by each hole. The inner track has one hole and it locates the home position of the disc. The middle and outer track have equally spaced holes around the periphery of the disc. Holes in the middle track are at the offset equal to half the width of the hole in the comparison to outer track holes. This is one is the inner track, this one is the middle track, this one is the outer track. Three tracks are available. So this one is the inner track. This is the one hole at it locates the home position. This one is the hole. Okay, this is the only one holes in the inner track. The middle track, this one is the middle track, and outer track are equally spaced holes. This one is the equally spaced holes. Okay. Holes in the middle track are at the offset equal to the half the width of the hole in the comparison to outer rack holes. This is the outer rack. This is the middle rack. Okay. The outer rack holes, intermediate this space, we have to middle track holes. If the shaft rotates in the clockwise direction, then the pulse in the outer rack lead those in the middle rack. Whereas if the shaft rotates in the anti-clockwise direction, the pulses in the outer rack lead those in the middle rack. This allows identification of the direction of rotation. This is the incremental encoder. Okay, this diagram represents the, this one is the sigma and sigma by 2. Okay. It's differentiate between the inner track, middle track, outer track. Okay. First one is the S by 2. It's nothing but the middle track and inner track. This one is the outer track. This one is the outer track. So sigma. This one is the space between the middle track. Okay. So we have to calculate the rotation of the incremental encoders. Thank you.